There was one joke that kind of made me gasp a little bit, was when the rabbi was behind in the office, you know, the back office, he's playing golf and you don't really see what he's
golfing into the chauffeur.
Yeah, he's golfing in the chauffeur, and I kind of gasped because I was like, I can't believe that a rabbi would golf into the chauffeur.
It's sacrilegious.
It's like basic. Yeah, it's like very sacrilegious.
Right. It's like putting with a crucifix.
Yeah.
You couldn't do that, you know?
Yeah.
And to be sloppy.
What's the matter?
There's cheese in this meat.
That's not kosher. Those two things, they go together so well.
Why are you Hi, welcome to The Real Generation Gap. I'm BJ Kang.
I'm Fred Satilli.
And the movie we're reviewing this week is the 2024 film Between the Temples. Another teacher-student love crisis. A Jewish widower gets his life turned upside down when his grade school music teacher re-enters his life as a new bar mitzvah student.
And you know, really his life got turned upside down when his wife had an accidental death.
Mm-hmm.
He was a cantor in a synagogue. That's a professional singer.
Yeah.
They sing their service. It's a little different. And his wife slipped on the ice and bashed her head open.
Mm-hmm.
And up to that point, he was good. But when that happened to her, he was no longer able to sing.
Yeah.
I see in institutions, especially academia, where people are not productive, but they're still paid. So the rabbi said, "That's okay. You're still on the payroll, you know. I'll do the vocal part. You're still part of, you know, we're keeping you." And that to have people that aren't actually performing a job. I've been on commission my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
I have no concept of drawing pay that's unearned just because I woke up in the morning. A life was provided. This wasn't 2-3 weeks. This guy had been on the fritz like that for more than a year, let's say.
Yeah, he's mourning for a while.
Right,
yeah.
So when are you going to come back, right? what are you doing to remedy your problem? If it's a problem with your faith, then you need to talk to your priest, your rabbi, or, you know, whatever it may be, and either restore your faith or turn your back on it altogether and move on. But they didn't do that. And this is a thing in academia. They have teachers who aren't teaching who are getting paid. They have professors that are on sabbatical or whatever, they're getting paid. They're not doing anything productive. And I resent that.
Mm.
I really do. And it's not the world according to Fred. So these things can exist, and they do.
Yeah.
But as for me as an issue, that was my first issue.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it speaks to one of like the themes of the movie, which is like community, right? It's like, yeah, like that's something to argue with when it comes to academia and stuff like that. But like, as for Ben, the main character, it's like in a Jewish community, it's like a very tight knit community, you know? And it's like, it's kind of like, you know, the people you go to the synagogue with are your family. I mean, a lot of Jewish tradition is really just like you're seen as part of like one very large family. So it's like it would make sense why they, you know, like even though he wasn't really performing his duties, that, you know, they might still keep him on because, you know, they understand that he's going through a very long extended mourning process and that, you know, but he's part of the community, which is like a very large aspect of this film.
It's very charitable.
Yeah. Charitable, for sure.
And I applaud that.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. And they certainly, that the Jewish community was not making a burden on the rest of America.
Yeah.
In other words, they were,
yeah,
they pretty much all agreed, their congregation or whatever you call it, is pretty much okay with this. There's nobody resenting this or mm-hmm. anything the way I did. Now, in this particular family, this guy had what I considered to be a curse. Let me put it to you this way. What's worse than having a Jewish mother?
What, Fred?
Having two Jewish mothers. And so his immediate family at home was he had two moms. Mm-hmm. It was a gay couple, two women that loved each other. And the interesting part there was one of them was a Filipina convert.
Yeah.
She was a Filipina. She converted to Judaism, and she was much more conservative than the natural Jew.
Yeah.
The natural Jew was very liberal. Mm-hmm. She's like, hey, let's just eat and everybody have a good time. And the Filipino woman was like, you're not following the rules.
Yeah.
I became a Jew. There was rules that I had to observe to become
one. She had
one
bone to pick, yeah.
And now these rules aren't being observed. She was kind of a militant Jew.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's terrible to have a crisis of faith. This guy did. It manifested in his inability to work anymore. And then he came upon a very unusual woman,
mm-hmm.
very, very unusual woman. And Carol Kane, First of all, Carol Kane has got a huge career. I don't know exactly when it started, but she was in one of these movies in 1975.
Yeah.
Right? And that's long, you know? And till now, her IMDb has like 100 entries, you know, different TV shows. And her biggest one was she was Simca on Taxi. And the TV show Taxi.
Simca, just go home.
You shouldn't go to work when you're sick.
Look, we cannot afford to lose a day's pay. And besides, I'm not really that sick.
Well, let me just see if you have a fever, all right?
All right.
Let me see. You're burning up!
I am not.
That's a raging inferno. Jim, tell me if you think he has a fever. Feel his head. Tony?
Something terrible has just happened.
What?
I've forgotten why I'm doing this.
He's hot.
He's hot.
She played a spectacular character, and that's when I became aware of her. Mm. And I just assumed that that would be her signature character for whole life. Like,
yeah,
she's Simca.
Yeah.
You know, the way Arnold is the Terminator.
Yeah.
Right? You see Arnold
Action
as the Terminator.
Star, yeah. A typecast, yeah.
You know. I mean, in the thing where he was the kindergarten teacher or something.
Kindergarten
cop,
yeah.
Right. He was still the Terminator, right? But I always thought she'd be Simca, but she did an award-winning job at playing the super quirky, freaky lady.
Yeah.
Who, because her parents were communists, she wasn't allowed to get a bat mitzvah when she was 13, I guess 13's the age,
yeah.
You know, and so now she won and won. The problem is she's 72 years old.
Mm-hmm. I actually, believe it or not, I have a little bit of experience with attending a Jewish service. For a project in college, I had to visit a sort of a church of a different denomination. I visited a Jewish messianic temple, mm-hmm. which is essentially Jews who do believe in, you know, Christ is the Messiah. Yeah. So they're like
Jews for Jesus.
Exactly. And so when I attended there, it was a very interesting experience because it's very liturgical, which means that it's very much like they do a lot of like tradition and sort of like the, like, so there's like steps sort of, or like a sort of order that goes about like their worship or their services. And to me, it was very interesting how very orderly and organized it was. And it was cool to see it like in this movie. It was I checked, and the movie is, I believe, written and directed by something Silverman. I think his name is Dennis Silverman, I think, perhaps. And he is
it's Silverman, right?
He is a Jewish director, and his movies often explore stories within Jewish life. And it was really interesting to see, like, to me, how I kind of saw it was that, like, this man, Benny, it's like, because, you know, the Jewish tradition is very liturgical and it is very organized, and they follow a lot of very strict laws, that when your life sort of gets thrown into chaos, you know, especially by losing a loved one, you kind of question, like, what's the point of like following order when life feels so chaotic?
Right.
Yeah.
That's a good observation.
Yeah.
That's a good, and I'm glad you had that experience going to the temple. Some of them were spectacular.
Yeah.
So anyway, I want to stay on the issue that I mentioned a moment ago, mm-hmm. about the convert.
Okay.
So you have these two women who are attracted to each other. One of them is a regular, good old-fashioned, mm-hmm. garden variety Jewish woman. And then there's a Filipina who decides to convert. And she does the study for mm-hmm. a year and everything. And she does the process, learns a certain amount of Hebrew. But it seemed to me that she valued her status as a Jew more than the actual Jew,
yeah,
more than the organic Jew. And this is the same thing with people who come
heritage,
to America,
yeah.
Who, you know, there are people who they come, not the illegal aliens, but the people who genuinely want to come here and have the right credentials and everything, whatever it may be, and they truly want to devote themselves. They want to say an oath to America,
yeah.
And they go through a study process for citizenship, and they value their citizenship. You know, if you talk to somebody from Eastern Europe or whatever who came here and they went through that process, or people from the East, the Orient, you know,
yeah,
they come here and they become Americans, and they are like militant Americans.
That's my father. That's my dad right there.
Right. He's like a good, strong thing.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that, people who value their citizenship.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that taking your citizenship for granted is really bad.
Mm-hmm.
I think people who aren't grateful to be born here and have the privileges that we do have and that kind of thing, I have nothing but resentment towards them. And I think it's bad. And this is another thing, along with the relationship mm-hmm. training, this kind of gratitude for your very life and then for your gifts of life, that should be there. It's a big issue with me.
You know, it's funny. I think that sort of like portrayal that you're sort of getting from, I see it a little bit differently, right? For one, it's like, Judaism is not just a religion. It's also an ethnic identity or sort of racial identity, you know? And so it's like for a lot
it's
of,
it's not a race.
A cultural identity that also has to do with, well, that also has to do with like ethnicity and stuff like that, because, you know, if your ancestors are Russian Jews
and Ethiopian Jews.
Yes, but those are, yeah, but even then it's like it has to do a little bit with like their culture, their almost national identity, because, you know,
it's not a national identity.
No, Judaism has to do specifically with the nation of Jacob, and the nation of Jacob is, you know, the people who inhabit the land that was given to them in Israel.
Okay.
Yeah, that's where, like, that's what Judaism really means.
That makes sense to me.
Yeah.
I can accept that concept. Yeah.
And so it's like a lot of, so the religious identity as well as the cultural and even ethnic identity is, you know, mixed up, or I'm sorry, intertwined is the best way to say it. So to me, when I saw her really pushing her about, like, there are steps you have to do, it was, to me, she had a bone to pick, because she, to me, it was like she was projecting the fact that she did not feel as Jewish as other people, as the, you know, other people who were definitely more like ethnic Jews and stuff like that, you know?
Right. You're a Jew with an asterisk. Like the rabbi's a Jew. The rabbi's wife is a Jew. Yeah. You're a Jew, kind of.
Yeah, yeah. She's a convert Jew. She's not like...
Right.
Yeah. She's not an ethnic Jew. So for me, when she was...
She's trans-Jewish.
But... for, you know, and for her to sort of, you know, push on her, it's like I had to do this work to be accepted in this community, for which, you know, I won't really feel like truly one of them, because I don't have that background, you know, that sort of...
Isn't it terrible when it's like that in life? Mm-hmm. When you're not really, you know, when you're not really the real thing, like you're not, you know, you always have that asterisk, you always have that, and that people who have that kind of condition always want to prove themselves.
Mm-hmm. You know? Exactly. And that's the point, was like she was projecting. It's like she has her own insecurities about her own identity. And so, and she sees this woman who is getting her bat mitzvah in like 3 weeks, like skipped a bunch of steps. And then she's just as Jewish as everyone else. She's got a bone to pick.
How dare you?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Right. So it's interesting that you saw it that way when I saw it like much different in that sense.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm just saying, because the way that you said it was like she had a more genuine faith, right? Because she couldn't, you know, because she was a convert. Like the same way in which, you know, immigrants are more patriotic than those who have been here, those who are born into, you know, our society and our democracy and stuff like that. And it's like I did not see that sort of analogy in the same way, because of like this is a movie that's written in the context very much so of like Jewish experiences. And so viewing it through that, it's like, it's not from a sense of she has a deeper, deeper sense of, I guess, genuineness. It's more of the fact that she is insecure because of her own identity as, you know, a convert Jew.
Authenticity.
Yeah, exactly. A convert Jew versus like an ethnic cultural Jew.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that's where I sort of said, like, I see differently.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the Cantor, he meets a 72-year-old woman. She says she wants to have the bat mitzvah. He says it's out of the question. It's a terrible idea. But the rabbi says, no, we're flexible here. We do things like this. We can work it out. And he starts to give her the training. And he starts to spend a lot of time with her. He's with her all the time. Because remember, this guy doesn't have a job, right? He goes home. His mother, where these two, his mothers, you know, they're doing their thing, right? So anyway, he begins to teach her and spending a lot of time with her. And he's a completely dysfunctional man. He doesn't sleep well. He doesn't eat well. He's sad. He is a big wet blanket throughout. He didn't get a laugh the whole movie.
Yeah.
He was not a comic character. She, on the other hand, is wacky. You know, she's really a fun, crazy character.
Yeah.
And they're together and they're together. And after 3 weeks, he says to the rabbi, I want to do the ceremony right now.
Mm-hmm.
And the rabbi says, well, you know, it's got to take a long time. So he says, well, let's figure out how to do it that way.
I believe it was because she had a stroke. She had a stroke.
You're right.
Yeah. So, I mean, and she said earlier,
like, do this before she dies.
Yeah, it felt like that because she said earlier when they first met that she had sort of like three like mini strokes or something
right,
like that.
Right.
And so like for him to speed up, you know, because a bar mitzvah is like a very like, you know, important cultural tradition for, you know, within the Jewish community.
And it's got to be done just so. And you have to sing your part. You have to speak in Hebrew. It's, you know, not just something you're reading off a card. You know? So he now because of that, because of her visit in the hospital, he wants to speed it up. And they start to figure out how they're going to do that. But then he says, I want to invite you to my house for dinner. We're having the rabbi and his wife and daughter. Meanwhile, he and the daughter, they had a one night, like a sex thing in the car.
Yeah.
You know. So they have had some contact with each other and kind of in a romantic way. And she thinks that she's his girlfriend. But when they have the dinner, his two moms are there. She's there. He's there. And the rabbi and his wife and daughter are there. And he announces that he's in love with Carol Kay. He's in love with the 72-year-old woman. The young girl is just laughing. She's
breaking down. She's hysterical.
Right. Yeah. Right. She's hysterical. Right. She's laughing instead of crying. She's like, "This is okay. This has got to be okay. This is, you know." And she realized her parents, they're aware that these two, you know, are.
Blodnick is unattached.
You know my daughter, Gabby.
Gabby Benjamin.
Gabby.
Hi, I'm Leah.
Like supposed to be together. That you know their daughter and this. They're like, "What's going on here?" Now at that moment, the Filipino woman, she says, "Oh, wait a minute! You were his music teacher when he was a young boy."
Yeah.
She goes, "You groomed him."
It's okay to be loud.
This is the culmination of grooming from when he was young. I said, "Wow, what a thing to add into the story."
Mm-hmm.
You know, they added in the homosexual women, which was not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
They added that in for no real reason.
Why'd you feel it was unnecessary?
Why was it necessary?
I mean, like, well, because, you know, gay people just exist.
No, they totally do, but it's not normal. The normal thing is a man and a woman. That's what's normal.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah, but movies are supposed to be, like, reflective reality.
They totally can, but what I'm saying is they injected this aspect of life, right? They had an abnormal couple, okay, there, which is completely acceptable. I don't have a problem with it.
Mm-hmm.
But Hollywood's DEI?
DEI, I mean?
Yeah, we get that. That's where I'm going with this. But anyway, so they injected the abnormal couple. Then they injected the grooming part, right, into the story, which I thought was another interesting, like today's social fabric that wouldn't have been thought of 30 years ago, wouldn't have been written into the script. But it was it was impressive to me that somebody, the Filipino woman, had this concept and recognized this could be. Now, this was not the case. She had not groomed him as a child, you know. But
yeah,
this is where these kind of questions come up now. When you see something, when you see people, they're this, they're that, you know, they're whatever their preferences are and everything and what happened and how they got there. It never used to be this way.
Yeah.
The family unit was very simple always. When I was growing up, the family unit was very simple. In my whole childhood, there was one widower. There was a man who the wife died.
Yeah.
You know, and that was an unusual family. And this guy had six daughters and a son. And he, now all of a sudden his wife died, you know, from cancer. But yeah, this is a real sign of the times thing when you have somebody that's aware of grooming. And everybody should be aware of grooming now because it goes on so extensively, right?
Yeah.
And it was interesting that the homosexual woman was the one, if it'd be one thing if a heterosexual identified this, but that a homosexual identified this, I thought was a little bit cool.
How so? I feel like grooming is pretty common knowledge for like anyone to know.
That you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
But it's something that's more or less denied by an unusual community. They don't want to be identified with that kind of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So she was a good whistleblower because she was from an alternate community. It's one thing if a straight couple said, well, we think this is a grooming, because that's sort of like straight couple paranoia, right?
Yeah.
But to have somebody from the gay community say, hey, wait a minute, this looks like potentially a grooming thing, I thought that was well played.
Mm-hmm.
That it was her that did that, you know?
Yeah.
So anyway, I watched the movie. I was not entertained by this movie.
Yeah, that was definitely an aspect I kind of felt too, was that it was not, it's very much a, it's a human story. It's like a very drama story. It's not really the most dramatic story either. This is like a sort of thing that could happen to like anyone, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Well, maybe not anyone, but it's like, it's a story that could happen out there. I'm not really certain also as to why it was, what made it, I guess, particularly cinematic, something that just sort of had to be seen on screen. However, I was able to see the merit of like, of essentially like what the movie was trying to portray, which was, to me, it was a story very much about like sort of a story about a man who is mourning, and you know, he's sort of lost out of touch with his faith because of that. But when his you know, the processes of his faith bring him to human connection, which is, you know, he now has to teach his old grade school teacher, you know, right, how to prepare for her bat mitzvah. You know, it's through that interaction, it's through that, you know, that connection he makes that he's able to sort of process and really get over, you know, that like kind of pit that he was stuck in from mourning for so long, you know.
But even though she was his music teacher, yeah, he did not retain his ability to sing.
Yeah.
In other words, I thought that he was going to all of a sudden, that their love would make him well able to sing again and he would be the spectacular Cantor once again or something. But he wasn't. It was a tragic story. Jason really drove it into the ground. I mean, any of the wacky stuff that Carol Kane did that was like kind of fun and entertaining, he the counterbalance there was overbalanced.
That's true, actually. I'm more used to seeing Jason Schwartzman as a comedy character too. I think the film I'm most familiar with him from is like Scott Pilgrim versus the World.
Mm-hmm.
So like that's really all I really had to like go off of when it came to Jason Schwartzman. I know I've seen him in other movies for certain, but in this one he definitely was able to give a very sense of like a man who's just tired. He's exhausted.
Yeah, he was destroyed.
Yeah.
You know, and he did not make a comeback. It's not a recovery movie. And in the end, this was a one of those slice of life movies where it just ends.
Slice of life, yeah.
And you're like, well, what ended up happening to them? Like, what happened to I wanted to know what happened to everybody in the movie. Like, how did the gay couple do? How did the rabbi and his wife do? How did the daughter do? How did everybody?
It kind of reminds me of the way American Fiction ended, if you remember, where there's like not really a resolution.
Right.
Yeah, because it's like, to me, the movie was like very, it was trying to be very grounded, like very slice of life. And once again, life sometimes does not have just satisfying resolutions. Things just sort of end suddenly, you know, sometimes. And like the whole movie, like it felt a little like the romance, quote unquote, everything that happened was very messy. And I think it was funny sort of like how, you know, it started off messy, his life, and then it kind of still ended off messy, but he was in a better, happier place, which is why I kind of disagree that he didn't have a
recovery.
Yeah, recovery, you know, because at the end of the, at the dinner table, he literally says, like, I'm happy.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. But he didn't look happy, you know, and then I think he did the bat mitzvah, just the two of them.
Yeah.
In the backyard somewhere, you know, and that was inconsequential. It wasn't satisfying to me. Mm-hmm. When I saw the movie, my leaving the theater, I was like, wow, what a drag, man. You know, and you know, there was $7 I'll never get back.
Yeah.
But it grew on me, and that's why I wanted to review it. Mm-hmm. And Carol Kane, when he professed his love to her at the dinner, she said, okay, thank you for inviting me to your home. I think it's time that I should go now. Everybody else was outraged.
Yeah.
Everybody but his natural mother, right? His Jewish mother that wasn't the Filipino one. She was like, that's okay. Everybody's good. We're good. Everybody eat. You know, you want some more of this and that. And she took it like really, really in stride. The Filipino mother, she was angry about it.
Yeah.
She was like, first of all, you're not having a bat mitzvah. You didn't do the steps. That's out.
I think.
Second of all, did you groom this kid? Like, she was really the boss of the group. Like, she was the smartest one in the group, you know?
It is a very Jewish movie.
Yeah, and they did a real good job of that. There's stuff that if you're not Jewish, you will never get some of the jokes.
You know,
some of the things that happened in there were, you had a, you know.
There was one joke that kind of made me gasp a little bit, was when the rabbi was behind, in the office, you know, the back office, and he's playing golf, and you don't really see what he's...
Yeah, he's golfing into the chauffeur.
Yeah, he's golfing in the chauffeur, and I kind of gasped because I was like, I can't believe that a rabbi would golf into the chauffeur.
It's sacrilegious.
It's like basic. Yeah, it's like very sacrilegious.
Right. It's like putting with a crucifix.
Yeah.
He wouldn't do that, you know?
Yeah.
And then he said, don't tell anybody I do this.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was kind of funny.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's a very Jewish movie. Like, there's a lot. But I like movies that have a very, like, deep sense of, like, very influenced by the cultural sort of.
Right.
You know, they do their research. Remember when we watched Stand and Deliver? It was very Chicano, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
And East Los Angeles. Well, it should be just the way this was.
Yeah,
this was
exactly.
Really done well that way.
Yeah.
You know, I think that the people in the audience when I went, they were very happy with the movie.
Yeah. So what was your rating again?
Well, I'm giving it a 5.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not for everybody.
Yeah.
Great for some people, totally terrible for other people. No young people are going to like it. Most Gentiles aren't going to like it. It's a pretty small audience there who would absolutely love it.
Yeah. I do agree that there's like, this movie has a lot of style, for you know, a lot of style that might be a little alienating, you know, non-conventional. As well as just like, you know, it's very culturally influenced by, you know, by Jewish culture, by Jewish faith and stuff like that, which I found cool as someone who's very interested in, you know.
Well, the marvelous Mrs. Maisel. I mean, who didn't love that, right?
As someone who's very interested in theology and is like, you know, same like you studied religion my whole life as well. And so, but it is not going to be for everyone. And honestly, it's not super exciting. And the love story is a little weird. For your grade school teacher to re-enter your life and you fall in love with them, very, a little icky, is the best way to say.
Yeah, totally, impossibly icky.
Very inappropriate. But I think it's a very sentimental like story of just human connection and community and just processing through grief, through mourning, you know.
Yeah, grief is bad.
Yeah,
and he certainly expressed it.
Yeah.
He really did.
So honestly, I will give the same rating. I will also say it's a 5 out of 10.
Okay, yeah. Well.
Thank you for watching The Real Generation Gap. Make sure to leave us a comment down in the comment section below. What did you guys think of this movie? And do you guys know any other movies you guys want to recommend that might be, you know, outside of the Hollywood mainstream, kind of like this movie? Let us know in the comments down below, and we would love to review them. Once again, thank you for watching, and we hope to see you in the next one. Bye.